Visakhapatnam, Andhra Pradesh. My hearty and warm welcome to our respected secretary and correspondent, Alvadas Group of Educational Institution, Dr. S.V.H. Rajendra Garu, to our honorable speaker, Professor K.V. Ramamurthy Garu, Principal Pharmaceutical Sciences, Andhra University, to all distinguished principals, professors, faculty, students, and participants across the country. From today onwards, we are conducting a one-week EFDP-SDP by pharma and healthcare professionals from 29 June to 4th July 2020. In association with IPA AP State Branch, powered by International Association for Academic Plus Corporate, the main object in conducting, due to COVID-19, we are all aware that it is difficult to invite guest lectures from our eminent persons from different colleges to empower students and faculty. Due to that, we have conducted these seminars online, which is benefited to not only our college staff and students across the country, it can be useful. Now I request our secretary and correspondent sir to speak some words regarding our session. Handing over this to secretary sir. Sir, venpatle sir, mute. Sir, we are not able to hear your voice. Rajendra garu. Sir, we are not able to hear your voice, sir. Secretary, sir, we are not able to hear your voice. Sir, we are not able to hear. Sir, when but less. మీ వాయిస్ వినబట్లేదు సార్. हेलो सर म्यूट Now we are at A1 session with our eminent and cognizant speaker, Professor K.V. Ravanmuthi sir, Principal, AU College of Pharmaceutical Sciences, Andhra University. He is a great teacher, reader, researcher, sincere, energetic, and enthusiastic professor with sensible knowledge behind his expertise. He encourages and shares his conscious and radiating knowledge with his students, scholars and fellow colleagues, and make everyone aware of the new development in the field of pharmacy. Today, I am very delighted, very much delighted and privileged to introduce our today's guest speaker, iconic professor of pharmaceutics, Professor K.V. Ravanmuthi sir, who is going to deliver a guest lecture on development of chronopharmaceuticals to suit circadian rhythms. Ravanmuthi sir, citation. Sir hails from Visakhapatnam. He completed his bachelor's, master's and PhD from Andhra University College of Pharmaceutical Sciences. He served as lecturer, assistant professor, associate professor, professor, senior professor in the Department of Pharmaceutics. His great research, thinking and execution is exemplified by his enormous international and national publication in reputed journals with high impact factor. He published 180 research papers and have 4 patents. He guided 51 PhD scholars and 113 M.Pharm projects. He was awarded with Dr. Aloysius Nargul Professor C.J. Shishu Best Research Award in Pharmacy by APTI in 2019, State Best Teacher Award in Pharmacy by Government of Andhra Pradesh on September 5, 2015. Dr. Salvepalli Radhakrishna Best Academician of the Year 2010 by Andhra University. APTI Teacher of the Year Award 2009 by APTI. Best Research Award 2005 by Andhra University in the 74th convocation and many more. Presently, he is serving as Principal Andhra University College of Pharmaceutical Sciences from 3-7-2019. Served as Chairman BOS AU College of Pharmaceutical Sciences, Member Consent for Operation AP Pollution Control Board and Member Environment Waste Disposal Committee. Academic Coordinator, RUSA, Andhra University since April 2016. Member, NAC Committee, Andhra University, Steering Committee, Andhra University. Placement and Training Officer, University College of Pharmaceutical Sciences, Andhra University, Visakhapatnam. He has membership in various professional bodies like Life Member in IPA, APTI, Registered Pharmacist, AP State Pharmacy Council, Indian Pharmacy, Graduates Association, Inspector for PCI and AICT, Editorial Board Member for various journals. Member Board of Studies to Sri Venkateswara University, Tirupati, Acharya Nagarjuna University, Biju Patnaik Technological University, Roorkela, Member of Scientific Steering Committee for AAPS, USA. This is the brief profile of our today's eminent speaker. We are fortunate to have you today, sir. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation on behalf of our management and our faculty. And our faculty, I once again cordially welcome you, sir. Sir, please proceed your lecture, sir. Now I am handing over this session to sir. I hope everyone will make avail of and the best use of it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sudhakar, for the nice words spoken about me. Yeah, a very good morning to all the participants of today's seminar. Today, the topic I have selected is development of corona pharmaceuticals to suit circadian rhythms. We are developing different types of dosage forms to meet the requirements of the patients suffering with different diseases and disorders. However, some of these diseases or disorders are going to show some fluctuations of intensity in their disease condition. And the conventional dosage forms cannot address them properly when the disease is at its peak state. Hence, there is a need for development of a dosage form which is going to address the peak time of this particular disease or disorder state to suppress it to the normal levels, and that is nothing but a corona pharmaceutical drug delivery system. If you just go into the history of this particular origination of the fluctuations, we are going to see majority of the organisms on the earth are going to experience predictable fluctuations of light and temperature effects due to earth rotation during the 24 hours period. And to resist these changes caused by this light and temperature due to earth rotations, they developed their own biological clocks for anticipation of these daily variations. And these biological clocks are going to maintain the temporal organization within the body, and it is going to coordinate with one another to make it comfortable life. And in humans, the master clock that is going to control all these activities, temporal regulation, is called as suprachiasmatic nucleus, which is going to control the body and maintain synchrony with each system. I'm just going to introduce some of the definitions which we are going to come across in this corona biology. One is homeostasis. It is a relative constant of inner biological environment. So the body is going to adjust itself to maintain a constant environment. And metabolic equilibrium is equally maintained by several complex biological mechanisms which are going to control through autonomic nervous system to offset the disrupting changes caused by the external environment. Myelointerior, this is environment within the system. Suprachiasmatic nucleus, it is a group of nerve cells that is located in the hypothalamus of the brain for controlling this. And Zeitgeber is a German word meaning the time giver. And biological rhythms are nothing but self-sustaining oscillations of endogenous origin. That means no external impulse is going to create these biological rhythms. Period, duration of time required to complete a single cycle. Level is the baseline around which rhythmic variations occur. Amplitude is measure of the magnitude of the predictable in time variable. Phase is clocking of specific features such as peak and trough values of rhythm relative to corresponding time scale. And the most important one we need to remember is the circadian rhythm. It is a Latin word with two parts, circa meaning about and dies means a day. So circadian rhythm means about a day. It is actually coined by Frank Halberg and Stephens in 1959. Chronobiotics are the drugs that are used for synchronization of the sleep and wake cycle to make the body work normal. So it is a chronobiological graph which I am going to present. You can see like a sine wave, we are going to have peak and trough model, and it is going to oscillate like this with an amplitude period as the earlier terms what I have incorporated. So what are the different types of periodical rhythms that are going to be observed in the body? They can be classified into three major groups. One is called as short period rhythm, which is less than 0.5 hours, that is half an hour approximately. So these are nothing but high frequency oscillations in the electric pulses of CNS and ANS, and pulsatile secretions of endocrine system. So majority of these body functions are going to be controlled by the secretions and the electric pulses generated from CNS and ANS, and these are called as short period rhythms. And many a times, we are not going to notice these rhythms at all in the body. Intermediate, they are again subclassified into ultradian, which is less than 20 hours, circadian, approximately equal to 24 hours, and infradian, more than 28 hours. And long biological rhythms are called as circa septon, approximately 7 days, circa mensual, approximately 30 days, and circa annual, approximately equivalent to 1 year. So these are all the different types of rhythms one is going to experience in the daily routine. So how the biological timekeeping is going to be kept in the body? So there is an inherent master clock, which I have mentioned already, is suprachiasmatic nuclei, and it is the central timekeeping mechanism, and it composes of different clock genes like PER1, PER2, PER3, BABL, and CRY, and their gene products. And it is also associated with the secretion of a hormone called as melatonin from the pineal gland. So this is the central timekeeping mechanism in coordination with the suprachiasmatic nuclei composing the different genes along with the hormone that is getting secreted from the pineal gland, melatonin. And this is a master clock, and this is going to coordinate with the different peripheral circadian clocks located in the different cells, tissues, and organ systems. And it is, all these are put together, they are responsible for the management of time or temporal organization of the biological processes that are going to occur in the human body. And normally, these biological clocks are synchronized for an extent of approximately 24 hours, and they are controlled by specific external time cues, which is called as Zeitgeber. And normally, we are going to experience the light and dark cycle, and this is how we are going to experience these biological rhythms. And how this is going to cause the stimuli or impulse, what we call. So there are three parts that are there in this particular rhythm or circadian clock. One is called as the input pathway. That means we have to create a signal. And normally, the signal is created by photoreceptors and projections of retinal ganglion cells. Pacemakers, which is going to stimulate, the stimuli that is generated by the input pathway is getting circulated to circadian signals to the different parts. And finally, it is getting converted to output pathway, which is going to couple the pacemaker to the effector systems that are nothing but the different cells. And normally, all this is going to be controlled by sleep activity cycle, and it is influenced by genetic makeup, and body functions of day and night are going to be controlled over a period of 24 hours. So it is pictorially represented here with two impulses. One is photoic signal, which I have mentioned, and non-photoic signal, which is in the form of an exercise. And that is the input, and the oscillator is going to generate it and communicate it to the different cells, which is going to be converted into an output signal. So if you just look at our body system, whenever a person is sleeping in a room, he always prefers to keep it dark. And anybody who comes into the room and switches on the light, though the person is in a deep sleep, you can see the blinking of eyeballs very violently sometimes if he is in a very deep sleep. Similarly, a person who is subjected for a severe physical stress always feels sleepy. So these are all the different signals of the biological rhythms in the name of circadian rhythms going to control the sleep and wake cycles of a human being. And it is very important to maintain this biological system. And any disruption that is going to cause in the circadian time structure, which is going to be controlled both by the suprachiasmatic nucleus as well as melatonin secretion, can be seen, and especially we can observe this disruption in people who are working the shifts, like morning shift, afternoon shift, night shift periodically, or the people who are traveling across the different time zones, persons traveling from India to America or America back to India, especially persons who are traveling back from America to India will suffer a lot because of this jet lag, and even during daytime of Indian time, they always feel sleepy because of significant difference in the time zones. So, and sometimes people who are going to be exposed to abnormal timings also going to get disrupted with this melatonin rhythm, and it causes sleep mood disorders and several health risks. And that is the reason why circadian rhythm is going to play a very vital role in the health care of a particular person. And nowadays, changes in our daily routines and lifestyles, majority of the youngsters are now suffering with these sleep disorders because they wake up in the morning at around 11, 11:30, had their breakfast at 12 o'clock, lunch at around 4 o'clock, and night dinner again at 12 o'clock or 9 o'clock, or after 11 to 1 o'clock in the midnight, and they go to bed only at 2 o'clock in the morning. So that is, for a period of time, is going to disrupt the melatonin cycle and causing various sleep mood disorders and several health risks. And even the biochemistry and physiology of human beings are also controlled by this 24-hour cycle. And you can see different types of hormones are getting secreted, which are very essential, which are essential for the growth. Please, 1 minute. For example, thyroid stimulating hormone, growth hormone, and lymphocytes, atrial neurotrophic peptide, eosinophils, all these are going to be secreted only from midnight to morning 6 a.m., which are very essential for major activities of the human beings. And different types of other systems are also going to work at different time points. So, if this cycle is disrupted, the secretion of these hormones are going to be disrupted, causing different types of health hazards. There is a reason why people are being advised to have a proper sleep and wake cycle, and not only sleep in darkness from 10:30 p.m. to 6:30 a.m. is most suitable time for all this maintenance of the biological or circadian rhythm. And even the diagnostic tests, what are being done for diagnosing different types of issues of a human being are also dependent on these particular circadian rhythms. For example, arrhythmia and response to intradermally injected allergens will get a good response, almost 2 to 3 times higher, when it is performed in the late afternoon and early evening rather than doing it in the morning times. And diagnosis of asthma can be effectively done when it is tested in the early mornings. And similarly, diagnosis of glaucoma, which is going to be highest between 2 to 4 a.m. and least in the late afternoon. Similarly, measurement of the hypertension will be highest in the morning and declines with the time and lowest at the night. So a person suffering with all these disorders or diseases, if they are tested in a wrong time, the clinician may get a wrong interpretation of the information and it may not lead to a proper diagnosis of the particular disease. And onset and severity of many of the diseases are also cyclic in nature. For example, heart failure, angina, asthma, all these are going to occur in the early mornings. And similarly, hemorrhage, ulcer, hospitalization, etc. is going to occur between 3 to 6 p.m. And osteoarthritis between 6 p.m. in the evening to night 9 p.m. to 10 p.m. Myocardial infarction 6 a.m. to 10 a.m., something like that. So all these are the different diseases which are going to show their maximum intensities only at a specific time point, rather than after that they go on decreasing. And these are the different examples. For example, gallbladder peptic ulcer attacks are more frequent at night. Acute pulmonary edema, congestive heart failure, and asthma, it occurs nocturnally. Infant deaths, symptoms of allergic rhinitis, etc., are going to be intense overnight in the morning upon waking. Migraine headache triggered during the rapid eye movement sleep or in the early morning. So one need to observe the severity of these diseases at what time, and accordingly, if we can address the treatment properly, the patient will have more advantage rather than giving 3 times a day or 4 times a day. And there are different research works that are carried out on the effect of these biological rhythms on the health and diseases. And Hastings is one of the scientists who is more keen in making a correlation between the different types of disorders or diseases with that of the biological rhythms. The first and foremost is biological rhythms and sleep disorders. So the importance of biological rhythms and sleep disorders can be discussed in terms of shift work and disorders of sleep and wake cycle. I already mentioned at the beginning of my slide itself, because majority of the shift workers are subjected for these sleep disorders. So and the second point also I already mentioned related to the youngsters, and majority of the youngsters may be cursing me, is talking too much about our habits, but it is a fact. With increasing economic and social demands, 20% of the population are working outside the regular timings, that is 8 to 5, and that is going to cause a lot of problem in the sleep. Frankly, I confess today before all of you, yesterday night I was working on the computer up to 1 p.m. 1 a.m. in the morning till, because of some issue what I'm having, and I could not have good sleep in the night. Up to 5 a.m. in the morning, I could have only 2 hours of sleep in the morning, because the continuous contact of my eye with the computer LCD monitor made me to lose my sleep habit. Normally, I go to sleep within 5 to 10 minutes the moment I lay down on the bed. But yesterday, I suffered a lot because of my severe working near the laptop for some other reason. So one need to be very careful in doing all these things. And it is going to have a negative effect on health and productivity, and it may lead to delayed sleep phase syndrome, advanced sleep phase syndrome, non-24-hour sleep wake syndrome, irregular sleep wake syndrome, time zone changes like jet lag and others. So how to address this problem? So the key center for regulation of the sleep is hypothalamus and the secretion of hormone, that is melatonin. So we are going to have a lateral hypothalamic hypocretin, which is called as orexin neuropeptide system, which is also responsible for sleep disorders as per the narcolepsy molecular techniques that are studied. And by giving melatonin, we can treat these sleep disorders to a great extent. If it is failing, then we need to go for additional drugs like theophylline and phentobarbital, which may be used to change the biological time structure by rephasing the circadian rhythm. And modern therapies include illumination with light has been used as an alternative approach to treat the sleep disorders. The persons will be exposed to a bright light for some particular time, for a specified time, hours, and then the light is removed. Naturally, the person who is exposed for this illumination of the light will get good sleep as per the theory. And the second approach is bright light therapy, which is also used to manage the circadian rhythm disorders, and we can come out of these problems. And biological rhythms and their effect on the respiratory diseases is also studied to a great extent. And majority of the allergic asthmatic patients are going to have nightmare during. We call it as nightmare because that is going to be very severe in the night, and especially in the early morning hours. So it represents the changing status of the biological functioning, and this chronotherapy of the respiratory disease, including administration of antihistamines and anti-inflammatory medicines in accordance with the day-night temporal pattern of the symptom manifestation. That means give more doses in the nights compared to the daytime doses for obtaining the maximum beneficial effects and limited toxicity. And there's a lot of work that was done on cancer research related to the biological rhythms, because cancer is one such dreadful disease in which the anti-cancer drugs are going to have both the beneficial effect as well as the toxic side effects, because majority of the cancer agents are going to cause severe toxicity to the healthy cells surrounding the cancer cell. Hence, it is always the aim of a researcher to have the maximum beneficial effect for treating the cancer cell and minimum toxic effect for protecting the healthy cells surrounding these particular cancer cells. So the toxicity and efficacy of the several anti-cancer agents is dependent on the circadian timing and their bolus administration of the particular drug, either in the single dose or in a continuous infusion pattern. And the timing of therapy is going to be very, very crucial, where the maximum resistance that is going to be offered by this hemobiotic system, which will improve the dose-limiting toxicity of the agent, because the maximum quantity of the anti-cancer drug is concentrating its activity only on the particular cancer cell rather than the other cells. Thereby, we can achieve the maximum beneficial effect, minimum toxicity of the particular agent. But the major drawback of this approach is how to identify the respective circadian rhythm. If one can have the correct identification of this particular circadian rhythm, where the maximum resistance of the hemobiotic system is going to occur, then the treatment of cancer is going to be very, very easy by using this circadian rhythm approach. And even the cell proliferation is also regulated by circadian rhythm. That means at particular time interval, the cell proliferation is going to be very high, and it is common both for normal and malignant cells, but the timings are different. Normal cells may proliferate at a particular time, the malignant cells may proliferate at another particular time. So, if we can target the anti-cancer agent to be the highest proliferation rate of this malignant cell, the anti-cancer therapy is going to be very, very effective. And they studied the anti-cancer agent, chlorpholamide, which is going to affect the survival of the target cells by clock genes and BMAL1 transactivation complex based on the circadian rhythm, and they could obtain very successful results. So we need to target this particular cancer cell by observing the circadian rhythm, and which will increase the effectiveness of these anti-cancer agents and also reduce the adverse drug events that are going to be caused by these anti-cancer agents. Biological rhythms in cardiovascular diseases. Hypertension is one of the most dreadful problems related to the cardiovascular diseases and follows a specific circadian rhythm. Whenever I discuss this circadian rhythm in the class also, I give an example of a father suffering with a hypertension. If a boy or if the children are interested in having something approved from their father, in the initial stages, whenever they approach the father in the mornings, he used to shout against them, because in the morning times, the blood pressure is going to be at the peak. So after certain experiences, normally the kids realized that we should not ask anything about our needs in the morning times, we should ask only in the evenings, because the blood pressure is going to be reduced to a considerable level in the evening times. And of course, there is a slight difference between the two different types of hypertensive patients. One is called as normotensive and essential hypertensive patients, which are called as primary hypertension, and displays highest values during daytime, followed by a drop in the night and an early morning rise. And secondary hypertension patients are going to exhibit peaks in the night, and daytime it is going to be low values. So accordingly, we have to address the therapy. So platelet aggregability, non-fatal myocardial infarction, and sudden cardiac death are having prominent circadian rhythms with the primary peak in the morning and secondary peak in the evening. So if you just look into the history of majority of these cardiac deaths, we'll be listening to the cardiac death of a particular person, especially in the morning hours before 8 to 9 a.m. Or rarely do we find the secondary peak in the evening, and very few cardiac deaths are reported in the secondary peak, which is going to cause the cardiac arrest. And so if we can formulate a dosage form to release the drug in a pulsatile manner, that can have better therapeutic effect, because we are going to control the release in a pulsatile way. That means initially the drug is going to release to the maximum possible concentration, and again the release is almost stopped or released with a very slow rate, and at a particular time point, again, it is going to release at a higher level. So we are going to modulate that but pulsatile release in such a way such that it is going to release at the peak level of the disease condition. So this may have better chronopharmacodynamics for the cardiovascular diseases and biological rhythms with neurodegenerative disorders. So if you look at the neurodegenerative disorders like epilepsy, Alzheimer's, Parkinson, etc., they are going to have the circadian rhythms, and it is also studied by Hastings et al. And they also follow a circadian pattern, and we can have the studies by using EEG electroencephalogram, we can observe at what time the peak of the disease is going to occur, and that can be addressed properly by designing a suitable dosage form. And metabolic disorders are also having the circadian rhythms, and normally suprachiasmatic nucleus is going to be coordinated for these metabolic cycles, and any disturbance in this coordination will lead to changes in the health, including metabolic disorders leading to problems like obesity, diabetes, and hypercholesterolemia. And these are going to influence the glucose transport, gluconeogenesis, lipolysis, etc., etc., and all these are going to lead to further damage. So if you just look at this particular presentation, alteration of food intake, the activity, and sleep, the first disruption that is going to cause is disruption of the tissue timings. And whenever the disruption of tissue timing is going to occur, disruption of coordination of biological process. And that is going to lead to metabolic disorders like diabetes and obesity. I'm sorry to comment here at this particular juncture. You look at majority of the software professionals. They always claim we are very busy. We are very busy. But if you look at their daily routine in a crude way, I'm saying except a few people, the moment they go into the company for their software job, within half an hour to 1 hour, they visit the canteen for a cup of tea. Along with the cup of tea, they try to eat some junk food and they come back to their seat. After 2 hours, again, they want to have a small break because they are always working near the laptop or a computer or some programming or something, and they want to have a small break, and again they go to the canteen. So like that in the office hours, because majority of the software companies are going to provide subsidized food and very good quality of food, and hence these people are very much habituated for going into the particular canteen area for a small relaxation, not for eating. Because they want to have relaxation, they go into the canteen, touch something, and they come back. So when this is going to happen over a period of 5 to 6 times during the daytime, there is an alteration in the food intake. Human body is designed in such a way such that morning the breakfast, afternoon lunch, and night dinner. But what these people are doing, they are giving the food intake for every 2-3 hours, and half the food is in the digestive state, and you are giving the fresh load of the food into the stomach. So that is going to change the biological rhythm, and that is going to inherently affect the activity and sleep, because they are continuously exposing their eyes to the LCD monitor on which they are working for their office work. That is going to cause a lot of impulse on this photoic response, causing the disruption of the sleep. And when that is caused, it is causing the disruption of the timing tissue timing, and further. And if you take the statistics, almost all the software professionals above the age of 40 to 45 are suffering with either of the diseases or disorders like diabetes, obesity, or hypertension, or joint pains, or something like that. So being a pharmacy professionals, you educate your friends. Don't disrupt your circadian rhythm. Unless you maintain the circadian rhythm, health is not perfect. And biological rhythms have significant effect on infectious diseases. And I'm just going to talk about that. So infectious diseases like caused by virus, bacteria, and parasites, or even the vectors, are following the circadian rhythms. And CD4 plus cells are going to exhibit diurnal variations. That is, morning, daytime, they are going to behave in one way. In the nighttime, they are going to behave in another way. And they are also going to cause in a non-periodical way. And the effect of the plasmodium growth on humans shows a periodicity. So whenever a person is suffering with malaria, if it is done in the morning, you may have one result. If it is done in the night, you may have another result. That's why a good physician always asks the patient to undergo this malaria test at least twice at two different time intervals to confirm whether there is malarial infection or not. So cyclic fevers also, the person looks normal at one point of time, but in the night he'll get severe fever and chills. So that is because of the circadian rhythms that is going to be exhibited by this plasmodium. And that is, even the vector, which is the mosquito vector, which is going to cause the malaria, is going to have a circadian rhythm. Peak indoor biting of mosquitoes is going to occur around 9:30, not exactly at 9:30, but around 9:30. And outdoor bitings will be higher after midnight. Again, I'm just giving a small example. Nowadays, we are all habituated for sleeping in air-conditioned rooms. But if you look at the summer sleeps in villages in good olden days, people used to close all the doors right from 5:30 or 6 o'clock until night 10:30, because they pretty well know that mosquitoes are going very high, coming into the house in a very large number, so that they will have mosquito bites. But after 10 o'clock, the mosquito bites are going to reduce to a great extent indoors. Whereas people who are sleeping outside, they normally used to come into the indoors after about 1:30 or 2 o'clock in the midnight, because the mosquito bites are going to be very high after the midnight. So this is also an example for a biological rhythm. So we have to take into account of all these things for treating the infectious diseases. The influence of age, race and gender also is there on the biological rhythm. And it's also going to be influenced by demographic situation, socio-economic situation, and work factors. And a study has been carried out between the Caucasians and Greenland Eskimos and suggested that there is no change in the lifestyle and food and ethnic variables, but circadian variation of problematic variables was observed between these two groups. So though there is no specific changes in the lifestyle and food and ethnic variables, there is a variation in the phenotypic variables between the Caucasians and Greenland Eskimos. And pediatrics also exhibit different biological rhythms in comparison with the adults, and it was well proved that administration of vitamin D in the evening for children who suffers with chronic renal failure rather than giving in the morning. That means the effectiveness of vitamin D is very high when it is administered in the evening compared to the morning. And our growth hormone production. That's why our elders always suggest us, allow the baby to sleep for more time. Because daily growth hormone production is approximately two-fold higher in young women than men, and also by 20-fold by sexual development status and age. That's why growth of women is very fast compared to men. And we can also see the organization of the biological process very well defined in women compared to men in the name of menstrual cycle and other things. So all these are the best examples for the effect of these biological rhythms on the age, gender, and other parameters. Biological rhythms and pain. The plasma concentration of C-reactive protein and interleukin 6 in patients with rheumatoid arthritis exhibited circadian rhythm. That means, whenever there is a change in the rheumatoid arthritis, it is going to cause severe pain. It is observed that the patients with osteoarthritis will have less pain in the morning and more in the night, whereas rheumatoid arthritis patients will have less pain in the evenings and very severe pain in the mornings. In fact, 1 year back, our pharmacy students in my guidance along with orthopedics department, we carried out a significant study on the effect of this pain on the rheumatoid patients and the dosage that is going to be given. We asked the patients to administer these drugs in the midnight, and patients suffering with osteoarthritis in the morning hours at around 9:30 or 10 o'clock, and we measured their pain intensity using the VAS scale, and it was observed that there is a significant improvement in their clinical pain compared to the regular taking of the dosage. So that clearly indicates that administration of a particular dose of a painkiller at the peak intensity of the disease, such that the Cmax is reached at the peak intensity of the disease state, it can kill, it can suppress the pain to a great extent. So we need to have proper information about the Cmax and Tmax values of the therapeutic agents, such that we can target these particular rhythms at appropriate timings to have maximum therapeutic effect. And now I'm going to give you some definitions related to this chronopharmacology, etc. So chronopharmacology is nothing but the study of the manner and extent to which the kinetics and dynamics of medications are directly affected by endogenous biological rhythms. So pharmacology, not we call it as the effect of drug. So here we are going to study the effect of drug in relation to the biological rhythm of a human being. Chronokinetics, it is rhythm dependent difference in the absorption, distribution, metabolism and elimination of medications, like pharmacokinetics. Chronodynamics, it is pharmacodynamics, but it is rhythm dependent. That means in the original definitions, we are not incorporating the time and rhythms. In these definitions, we are incorporating the rhythm dependent as well as time dependent. Chronotherapy is nothing but treatment of a particular disease by administration of a dosage form with respect to its circadian rhythm, and it is modulated to find the times for drug delivery that result in low toxicity with highest beneficial effect. And chronopharmacokinetics, it is only a new word that is introduced, that is nothing but the temporal changes, that is time related changes in absorption, distribution, metabolism and elimination, and it is going to describe all other parameters like that of the pharmacokinetics as given by the American Association of Medical Chronobiology and Chronotherapeutics. And it is similar to pharmacokinetics like ADME, but here we are going to observe it with respect to time. And chronopharmaceutics is a branch of pharmaceutics devoted in the design and evaluation of a drug delivery that releases the bioactive agent at a rhythm that ideally matches the biological requirements of a given disease therapy, and it should embody the time-controlled and site-specific drug delivery. Here, we have to address this with two important points. One is time control. That means the time of release should be modulated in such a way such that the Cmax is at its highest level. Cmax is at its highest level at the highest intensity of the disease state. And it should be highest at the site where the disease is going to occur. So these are the two important points that are to be incorporated in the design of chronopharmaceutics. And chronotherapy is synchronizing the drug delivery with circadian rhythm. And this is one more important definition, which is called as chronesthesy. It is the cyclic changes in the susceptibility or the sensitivity of the target system. That means we are administering a drug to attack a particular receptor, which is the target in the body. So what cyclic changes that are going to occur in that particular organ target is going to be studied in the name of chronesthesy. So it is almost similar to the pharmacodynamics, what we call, that is effect of the drugs on the body. And it is going to give an information about the performance of the drug, which is resulting at the cellular level. And we have different examples like alterations in key proteins in the cell membrane of brain cells, changes in the response of cell membranes to chemicals needed for cell communication. So these are the drugs which are going to alter these responses of these brain cells or the ocular cells or other things and interrupt the cell communications. So chronoesthesia is going to explain all these parameters. And chronoenergy is another branch of chronopharmacology. It is going to discuss about the influence of drug on the organism's biological rhythm along with the influence of time on drug's effect. That means it is going to get the information related to both pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics together to assess how a drug is going to exert its influence on the body in relation to the biological rhythm and time of administration. So it is in a way almost a combination of pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics. And what is the influence of the circadian rhythms on the pharmacokinetics? Before we design a dosage form, we need to know all these things, because there are certain drugs which are going to be influenced by the time of administration about the pharmacokinetics. So, as the general rule, we believe that the pharmacokinetics are conventionally considered to be constant in time and are influenced by different physiological functions displaying the CRs. And changes in any gastric secretion, gastric motility, or gastrointestinal blood flow, or drug protein binding, liver enzyme activity, blood flow, etc., etc., are going to be time dependent, as we have already seen in our previous section, where these are going to be at their peak at some points of time, at their low at some points of time. Accordingly, whenever a drug is getting affected for their pharmacokinetics by these parameters, they are going to be influenced for the pharmacokinetic variations. And there are several studies that are conducted, and my humble remembrances, Professor Rambo from Kakatiya University, he has done a lot of studies on these chronopharmacokinetics and published very good publications in the field of this chronopharmacokinetics. He has produced almost 8 to 10 PhDs in the chronopharmacokinetics by using different types of drugs. So he proved beyond doubt that the pharmacokinetics of the majority of the drugs are considerably and significantly affected based on the time of administration, and we need to take into account about these pharmacokinetic changes. So how these pharmacokinetics are going to be influenced? They are going to have changes in the rate or extent of bioavailability when they are taken in the morning or in the evening. That means if you take them in the morning, there is a change in the bioavailability, like increased or decreased. Similar is the case in the evening. So if you take nifedipine, boron nitrates and propofol, they show peak plasma concentrations almost 2 times high, and time for peak plasma concentrations are reduced very much when they are given in the morning compared to evening dose. But the same drugs, when they are given in the sustained release formulations, they are not showing any significant effect on the pharmacokinetics. So in the next slide, these are the different drugs that are going to show variations in the pharmacokinetics to the circadian rhythm. So if you take etanolol, it is going to be absorbed at a faster rate in the evening than in the morning. So the reason is absorption of the lipophilic drugs are faster after morning dose than in the evening. That means etanolol is a non-lipophilic drug, hydrophilic, propranolol. It is absorbed faster in the morning than in the evening. It is lipophilic. Indomitacin is having more bioavailability when given in the morning than in the evening, because greater blood flow to the GIT in the morning than other times. Doxorubicin, total body clearance was less due to change in the hepatic blood flow, however, renal clearance was not altered. So nicotine, which is very interesting drug on which a lot of research was done related to chronopharmacokinetics, which I'm going to present in the coming slide. So there is a variation of nicotine kinetics about 17% from peak due to the changes in the daytime and nighttime, and whenever there is a meal that is taken, nicotine is eliminated from the body, that is clearance is increased by 42%. So if you look at the smokers, after every meal, within half an hour or 45 minutes, they want to have a smoke, because the nicotine content in their body gets depleted at a very faster rate after the meal. Hence, the majority of the smokers will try to smoke within half an hour from the completion of the meal, because nicotine is getting excreted. So for suppressing this, they actually, for the smoking cessation, people have designed the nicotine transdermal patches. And because these are not successful, the reason is it is going to release the drug at a constant rate. But some scientists have changed the TDS patch design in such a way such that initially there is an early high delivery rate, because they need to get the minimum concentration of nicotine in the blood. Later on, it is going to release at a constant rate in a slow way. And when there is a meal that is going to be taken according to the time controls of the patient, again there is a slight rise in the nicotine content from the TDS patch. And in the night, because nicotine is not going to be cleared at a faster rate in the night, the nicotine delivery from the transdermal patch is going to be controlled at a very slow rate. That means we are going to have four different modulations of the drug release of nicotine from the TDS patches that are designed, such that initial doses are going to be reached very quickly, and a constant release is going to occur for a period of time. And whenever the patient is going to have the meal, because of the improved clearance of the nicotine, they need to compensate the loss that is caused to the clearance by releasing higher quantities. And in the night, nicotine clearance is going to be low, and hence the release is going to be very slow. So these are all the approaches that we have to take into account. And now the design of a chronotherapeutic drug delivery system. So there are different types of routes that are used for delivery of this chronotherapeutic drug delivery, using parenteral route, transdermal route, and oral routes. So through parenteral route, there is a system called as Melody system, which is a pre-programmed infusion pump. These are all the patented delivery systems, and it is used successfully in cancer chemotherapy in US and European countries. That means we are going to modulate the delivery of the anti-cancer agent in this particular Melody pump, such that the drug is going to be released at a predetermined time intervals. And programmable synchronized PanoMat, V5 infusion and rhythmic pumps, chemical oscillators, all these are the different pumps. These are also having the possibility of the pre-programming the pumps. And the chemical oscillators is going to act as pH oscillator system by buffering mechanism. So whenever there is a change in the pH of the system, there is going to be a change in the release pattern of the drug. So there are buffers and other systems that are incorporated to compensate this loss, and accordingly the programming can be done. And there is one more technology that is developed called as microfabrication technology. And it is going to achieve a pulse-style chronopharmaceutical drug release. And majorly this technology is being used for insulin delivery. And it is going to measure the changes of glucose concentration in the body, and accordingly the release of insulin from this particular microfabrication technology device is going to be controlled. And it is going to be controlled by a microfluidic system, and it is a hydrogel based on phenylborolic acid. And further modification of this technology led to the development of the microchip delivery of the insulin. So these are all successful in the market. But one thing I'm going to give you clarity, these are all the systems which are comparatively very high in cost compared to the conventional deliveries. But in the need of the delivery of a drug, for example, diabetic patients having very high fluctuations of the blood glucose levels are requiring these types of systems, because every time they cannot take the consultation of a doctor for maintaining their blood glucose levels.
Governor.
So transdermal route, we have crystal reservoir system in which there is a liquid crystal that is going to be designed, which is a single. A single or a binary liquid, which is going to have an on-off switching system for the transdermal application, and based on the impulse, like a temperature cycle change, or it may be stimulated by the dosing time or the therapeutic needs for the human body. That means the signals may be different, like a temperature change or a stimulation of the dosing time. That means we are going to define this is the dosing time for which the crystal reservoir system is going to be activated. Or by measuring the therapeutic needs, by measuring the blood glucose level, if it is dropping, it will be stopped. If it is increasing, insulin is going to be pumped into the body. So these are all the TDDS type of systems that are being designed. And the second model is automated transdermal drug delivery, which is also called as ChronoDose. It is a system and it is like a wristwatch which can be pre-programmed to administer the drug into the body automatically at different times of the day and with varying dose sizes. So normally in the mornings to evenings, the persons are habituated for taking some food. So accordingly, the blood glucose level is going to be altered at higher levels compared to the night times. Hence, the morning time dosing interval as well as the dose schedule is going to be slightly higher compared to the night time, and accordingly to the program. And it is no way connected with the patient's biological system. That means whether the patient is in sleep or in a awake condition, it is going to do its duty and it can be tailored to the specific needs of a particular person. And coming to the oral route, there are different technologies in the chrono drug delivery systems which I have listed in an elaborate way, which I'm not going to discuss because majority of the systems are already discussed by many textbooks and other books. So just I'm going to give the names and the principles involved in this particular type of systems. Majority of the systems are pulsatile in nature, where the drug is going to be released in a pulsed way. And there are a number of patents that are filed in the chrono pharmaceutical technology, like the patents and references are already given by me here. And commercialization of these chrono pharmaceutical drug delivery systems. If you take the European market and the American markets, there are a number of commercial formulations in the name of chrono pharmaceutical drug delivery systems. But unfortunately, Indian regulations did not give any scope for the development of these chrono pharmaceutical drug delivery systems. In fact, the work what we have done in our laboratory got the attraction of some of the pharmaceutical companies in India. But unfortunately, though they are successful in developing the final formulation, at the time of regulatory approval, still they are not in a position to get the right approvals, and hence they are not able to market these chrono therapeutic drug delivery systems. But in other markets, there are a number of populations and the market is ranging from about 4 to 10% of the total conventional dosage form market. So you can see, I have given an exhaustive list of majority of the formulations available. And what is the interest in this particular topic for us? Because always in my laboratory, my group of students who are going, who work with me are interested in novelty of research work every time. So I'm fortunate to have such scholars in my laboratory who work under my guidance. And one such researcher is capable of developing this particular chronotherapeutic drug delivery system. And I know the difficulties we faced during the progress of the research work. Initially, we faced a lot of issues related to the compression, calibration, everything. Once these are standardized and stabilized, we are able to do good number of publications in the chronotherapeutic drug delivery systems. The first work what we have carried out in our laboratory is indomethacin chronotherapeutic drug delivery system. And the objective of this particular work is to develop a chronotherapeutic drug delivery system with a lag time of 6 hours release. and to complete the drug release within 1 hour to meet the circadian rhythm of a rheumatoid arthritis. Normally, the rheumatoid arthritis intensity of the pain will be very high in the morning hours between 3 to 6 hours, as per the reports I have already mentioned. So, if we are able to deliver this drug at its Cmax value at this particular time period, the patient will have a soothing effect for suppression of the pain. So, what we contemplated is the Tmax of this particular drug is approximately 1 to 2 hours maximum. Hence, by administering the drug at around 9 to 9:30 in the evening, that is the night before going to the bed, there is a lag of 6 hours, and as the drug release starts in the morning at around 3 a.m. to 3:30 a.m., and the complete drug release is going to be obtained within 1 hour, that means total period of 7 hours, we assumed that the Cmax will be reached at around 4 a.m. in the morning to suppress the severity of the rheumatoid arthritis pain. So with that objective, we have made this particular aim. And the problem with this particular indomethacin is it is a very poorly soluble drug. So achieving the complete drug release within 1 hour is a big challenge. So initially, we tried to enhance the solubility of this particular drug by using a solid dispersion technique, and we used 2 different grades of sucrose fatty acid esters, because earlier workers have already tried with cyclodex compensation and other approaches, but the improvement in the solubility is not up to the level what they have contemplated. Hence, we have selected new carriers, sucrose fatty acids. We are the first one to report the effectiveness of the sucrose fatty acids for the improvement of solubility during that time. And we have selected 2 different sucrose fatty acid esters with different HMA values for the preparation of solid dispersions. And these solid dispersions were optimized for the complete drug release, and the core tablets were prepared, and the core tablets were also optimized for the complete drug release within 1 hour, and the preparation of the chronotherapy drug release system was attempted by using a compression coating technique using different grades of polyethylene oxide polymers. We like WSR-303, coagulant, etc., etc. And finally, the optimized formulations were subjected for drug release studies and stability studies. And as we wanted to evaluate these formulations in the human volunteers, we have developed a method for the estimation of the indomethacin by using HPLC, using the blood, using serum. And we compared the efficacy of this particular dosage form in comparison with the commercial conventional release tablet of indomethacin, Indicap. So this is the flowchart of the preparation of these particular dosage forms. And this is how we have prepared the compression coating. This is the flowchart of the compression coating. And this is the cross-section and the transverse section of the compression-coated tablet that was prepared. The center one is the core tablet, and the surrounding is the PEO, different grades of polymer that is used for the compression coating. So here we just made the colored tablet of the core, colored core tablet, because we distinguish it from the core that the coat that is applied on the core tablet to see how the coating is uniform, etc. But in the required preparation, we have not used any color. So the outcome is we achieved the desired lag time of 6 hours with the optimized formulation, and 100% of the drug release was achieved within 1 hour after the lag phase, and there is a good correlation between the percent drug release in vitro and percent drug absorbed in vivo, that means linear correlation. And there is no variation in the pharmacokinetic parameters of the optimized formulation after the lag time. Very important point is, because there is a lag time of 6 hours, we should not consider this phase for the pharmacokinetic calculations. But immediately after the end of the lag phase of 6 hours, it is almost similar to that of the conventional formulations. So these are the comparative dissolution graphs of the pure drug and the other API and other things, commercial formulation. You can see the clear lag phase that is obtained for the optimized formulation. And we did not observe any release of the drug in the lag phase period. Not more than 5% of the drug was observed in all the cases. And this is the bioavailability in vivo study curves. So you can see there is no significant difference in the AUC and other parameters statistically when they are subjective for studies in human volunteers. Again, yesterday also I mentioned in my another webinar, in those days, getting the ethical clearance for carrying out human studies is not that much difficult, and we are fortunate enough to carry out all these studies in the human volunteers for the study. But nowadays, the ethical clearance is becoming a big issue, and invariably we need to go for animal models. The second drug what we have used is losartan for development of a prolotherapeutic drug delivery. In all these cases, we tried to use only the compression coating technique, which is more useful in the laboratory conditions compared to the other approaches. But on the industrial perspective, we can even go for the other coatings like Worcester coating or pan coating or other coating technologies, depending upon the necessity. But in our laboratory conditions, compression coating is going to be more comfortable compared to the other systems, and we always prefer the compression coating technology. So here also the goal is to achieve the complete drug release within 1 hour after the specified lag time, and the specialty of the study is, in the previous case of intermetazin, we have used PEO polymers for the compression coating, but in this case, we wanted to use the natural gums, which is our primary interest of research, because another school of research is evaluation of the natural gums as pharmaceutical excipients. And we are working with gum caraya, and we wanted to compare its suitability for the compression coating on par with the established natural gum, gaur gum, and semi-synthetic polymer, HPMs. So we observed that the lag time is not optimized properly. So we added the wicking agents in different ratios in the coating polymer, such that during the dissolution period, some quantity of this wicking agent is getting dissolved or eroded from the coating, whereby channels are created for penetration of the dissolution fluid into the core of the tablet to facilitate the release of the drug from the core tablet. So we have done that particular experiment also, which is a novel approach. And finally, we optimized the formulations. And here also, we developed the HPLC method, and we also optimized for its in-vivo performance. And it was proved that the results are in coordination what we contemplated. That means the contemplated lag time of 6 hours is reached, and the Tmax is reached within 1 hour with a good level A in vitro in-vivo formulation. So these are the results just I'm presenting here. And the third one is torsamide, which is a BCS class 1 drug, antihypertensive. And we have used different agents and prepared the core tablet, and again optimized all these things. And these are the results that are obtained. Here we have not done any in-vivo studies, only we stopped with in-vivo. And another drug that we have studied is Montelukast, which is an anti-asthmatic drug. And here also, we use the same approaches. And enalapril malate also, we have prepared a similar way. And in all the cases, almost all the cases, the lag time that we contemplated is approximately 6 to 7 hours, such that the complete drug release is going to be achieved within the desired period. Because all the populations, what we try to attempt, are what we prepared, are going to be addressed for the morning sickness. That is, in the morning between 3 to 6 a.m. diseases like hypertension, asthma, or rheumatoid arthritis, etc. And hence, the major goal of our study of lag time is approximately 6 hours. And almost all the drugs are having the Tmax of 1 to 2 hours, and Cmax will be reached within this particular period. And that's how we selected the drugs in such a way that the formulations can be prepared. So these are the different publications. Of course, the impact factors are those days impact factors. Now drug development and industrial pharmacy is about 3.5, and current drug delivery is 2.6, something like that. Even the Daru Journal of Pharmaceutical Sciences is also having very good impact factor. So these are all the good papers what we can generate with the coordination of my students who are very keen in preparing these chronotherapeutic drug delivery systems. So, I would like to conclude. So, the audience is, whenever anybody is interested in preparing a chronotherapeutic drug delivery system, they need to develop a good literature backup first, containing the entire pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic profile of the drug that is selected for development of the chronotherapeutic drug delivery. What is the Tmax value of this particular drug? What is the Cmax that is expected to be attained? What is the minimum effective concentration that is suitable for this drug to start its action? And what is the chronobiology of the disease for which this drug is being addressed? And what is the circadian rhythm of that particular disease that is being followed? So, unless we have the clarity, and majority of the recent publications, what I came across on this chronotherapeutic drug delivery, I found that the objective of the treatment is to immediate dosage form in the brain. But when we see the drug release, it becomes like, it behaves like a controlled drug therapy. So, in chronotherapy, the objective is very, very important. That means we have to have immediate release first. If you are interested, you can generate a pulsatile drug delivery like that. That means we have various approaches like cupping, tablet, or tablets in capsules, something like that, where we will be preparing the different release pattern tablets which are inserted into a capsule, three numbers or four numbers. One is going to release immediately, the second one is going to release the drug after 2 hours, the third one is going to release the drug after 6 hours, something like that. We can modulate such that. And last but not the least, because we are preparing the form that is going to be released only after 6 hours, what is the absorption of this particular drug into the systemic circulation? From which part it has this specific absorption? For example, if the drug is having absorption in the stomach, your total design of chronotherapeutic drug delivery with the lag time is a big deal. Because by the time the drug starts releasing, the dosage form is going to be landed either in the small intestine or in the large intestine. So the drug must have proper absorption characteristics at that particular pH and at that particular GAT, where it is going to be located at the time of its release from the dosage form. So it may look very simple to start the research, but once we start, we need to answer these queries very critically before developing a therapeutic drug delivery system. And take this as a cue from my experience, what we have done. You can start your own research related to this particular chronotherapeutic drug delivery system development, such that in future, your product may also be in a market for getting part of revenue for your research. And I thank Srinivas Rao College of Pharmacy for giving me this excellent opportunity to share my thoughts on this chronopharmaceutical drug delivery system and their designs. I thank the secretary and correspondent, Dr. Rajendra, and Principal Sudhakar, all other faculty members who are the backbone of this particular organization of this seminar. And last but not the least, all my friends who are listening to me with their faces. I thank everybody for their patient listening. These are all the various references I'm trying to collect. And last but not the least, namaskaram to everybody in the pandemic situation of COVID-19 instead of saying thank you with a shake hand. So, all the best to everybody and thank you and good day for everybody.
I sincerely thank you for your priceless lecture, sir. It is really a revolutionary lecture, thing which everyone will certainly benefited with this session, sir. Thank you once again on behalf of our management and faculty for accepting our request and spending your precious time with us, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for supporting staff, students, and to all participants for making this session very successful. Tomorrow we will meet again with day two session with an honorable speaker, Professor K.P.R. Chaudhary, sir, on the topic role of biopharmaceutics in drug development. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay.